perhaps you're like me, with troubles coming from every direction, you have a tendency to get frustrated, anxious, upset. It's so difficult to stay calm. If only I could trust God and stay calm. That's the invitation that He gives us as He gives us His Word, to trust Him in the midst of the storms. He's right there. When Jesus wanted His disciples to grow in their faith, after they saw the miracle of the feeding of the thousands, He puts them in a boat and tells them to go to the other side. And often when we're going to the other side, when we're moving from one dimension of faith to another, we find ourselves in the middle of a storm like the disciples did. A storm, fear, frustration, totally coming over them. And if that wasn't bad enough, they're in the middle of it all. They see what appears to be a ghost walking right toward them. They're about ready to jump overboard. They're everything but calm. Instead, they hear a quiet voice that says, "Don't be afraid, it is I." The challenge for you and me in the middle of the storms of life, when God wants to take us over to the other side, is to hear His voice when He says, "Don't be afraid, it is I." That's a challenge that He gives every one of us, to stay calm and to trust God. Paul says it very clearly in the Word of God. I love this verse. I use it over and over because I have to hear it myself and apply it, where he says, "Be anxious for nothing. Be anxious for nothing. Don't be anxious about anything, but in everything, in every situation, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God." If I could just remember that instead of panicking, if I could just remember that to stay calm and instead of panicking, pray and know that that which is coming toward me, maybe across the troubled waters, is not a ghost and I don't need to jump overboard, but instead is the Lord Himself who's come to join me in the midst of my trials and tribulations. The Lord who can speak to every storm and say, "Be still." There's so many things that can upset us. There's so many times that we make things worse when He's trying to take us to the other side. We may have to go through a season of trials and tribulations, but our tendency to panic only prolongs that season when God may have intended it to be a short period of time. Through our unbelief, through our fear, we have a tendency to make it much longer. The children of Israel did that. The Lord anticipated and desired them to go to the promised land in less than 3 years. But they get out there in their doubt and their fear and their worry and they can't stay calm and trust God, they prolong the journey to 40 years. Maybe you and I have been out here in the wilderness for 40 years. It's time we go to the promised land. And the only way we're going to get there is if we learn how to stay calm and trust God. And that's the challenge that He gives each one of us at this time. Ben Stein is quoted as saying, "Faith is not believing that God can, it's knowing that God will." Did you get that? Faith is not believing that God can, is knowing that God will, experiencing His peace that passes all understanding, knowing that God will. And what will He do? He's promised that He'll never leave us nor forsake us. He's promised that if two or three agree here on earth about anything, it'll be agreed upon in heaven. He's promised that a mustard seed of faith can move a mountain. So there we are facing that mountain. Instead of panicking, let's pray and let's let that mustard seed of faith cause the mountain to be moved. Stay calm and trust God. That's what He's challenging us to do. And we can stay calm if we know that God will do what He told us He was going to do in Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6, where He tells us in the midst of our troubles, it says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to Him and He will make your path straight." Paul goes on and tells us in Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, where he says, "Whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things." Think about such things. I've shared this before with individuals. Why worry when we can think about that which is admirable, that which is good, that which is whole, that which is pure? To put the best construction on everything is perhaps a way of summing it all up. And that's what he's telling us to do at this particular moment. Again, back to what he said earlier, be anxious for nothing. Ah, it's so easy to get anxious. It's so easy to get upset. How do we stay calm in the middle of that? But everything with prayer and petition or supplication to let our requests be made known unto God, knowing in our hearts that not only God can, but God will. And he tells us that over and over in His Word, God will. In other words, you know, can we trust in God at moments like this that He will deliver us? Can we stay calm? Can we know that all things do work for good to them that love God and called according to his purpose? In order to kind of stay calm and trust God, somehow all the stuff we got in our brain that we know that God can needs to get into our heart. And we experience that God will. And the peace of God that passes all understanding shall be yours in Christ Jesus. If you can do that. If you can just allow the Lord to begin to do that. So right now, at this very moment, instead of being anxious, instead of being troubled, instead of being fearful, instead of being upset, let's surrender to him and know that God will. That God will. St. Augustine had this to say. He said, faith is to believe what we do not see, and the reward of this faith is to see what we believe. Yes. Faith, as Hebrews 11 tells us, is the evidence of things not seen. That faith is evidence. That's what it is. And that's what God is calling us to do, to exercise that evidence now and experience the peace of God that passes all understanding. There's so many things that can trouble us. So many things that can upset us. So many things that can just swallow us in a pit of hopelessness, despair, anxiety, tension, and frustration. But we can know in the depths of our soul that God will deliver us. Think about Joseph. Joseph didn't anticipate that morning when he got up and went out to greet his brothers out in the field that he was going to end up in the bottom of a pit. But they were jealous of him. They were upset with him. Their father had made this beautiful robe. And their father obviously loved them, loved Joseph more than they did them because, again, it's Rachel's son. And then Rachel actually died when she had her second son, Benjamin. And he really lavished his love upon Joseph. And then Joseph had this series of dreams that alienated his brothers even further. And so here he comes. They see him from a distance. And they say, here comes the dreamer. Let's kill him. We're going to kill him. Well, Judah intervened. Reuben intervened. And Reuben got him to say, okay, let's put him down in this pit. Let's not kill him right now. And Reuben's going to free him later. But he comes back. And Joseph's down in this pit. And along comes some Ishmaelite traders, Midianites, and they took him, his brothers sold him into slavery for 20 pieces of silver, the same amount that Judas betrayed Jesus for, and that was the average price of a slave, 20 pieces of silver. And Joseph is taken, and he's put in Potiphar's house. Now, when he's in that pit, everything seemed like a great big mess. And it's very difficult for him to stay calm, but somehow he found in the depths of his soul that, okay, I'm going to trust God. I'm going to be calm. All right. He gets there in Potiphar's house, and God blesses him. God's obviously with him. Potiphar sees it, and then what he does is he elevates him to control of all. Next thing you know, though, Potiphar's wife is trying to seduce him. Joseph resists. He's lied about. He's tossed into prison. About that time, it would have been easy for any one of us to just lose it. But he stayed calm, and he continued to trust God. And out of the prison, God brought him out of the pit, then God brought him out of the prison, and he became number two in Pharaoh's court through the interpretation of Pharaoh's dreams. And his brothers came back, and here's this guy that was in the pit that God used to save the then known world through the 7 years, if you read the story, of plenty. He served a lot of food, and that time in the 7 years of starvation, he was able to feed the world. From the pit, from the prison, to the palace, because one man stayed calm and trusted God. Now, you may be in the pit right now. You may feel like you're in the prison. There may seem to be no way out. But in the middle of it all, can you stay calm and trust God that he's using all this to take you to the palace, to take you into a presence that you've never had before with the living God, that you can remain steadfast, immovable, abounding in the will and the work of God? Maybe you're like Daniel, though. You've continued to remain steadfast doing that, and you're praying. And the wicked people around you get you thrown into a lion's den. And there you are in the middle of a lion's den. What does he do? He took Daniel out of the lion's den, I took Joseph out of the pit, and out of the prison, and put him in the palace. Or Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, thrown into the fiery furnace. I mean, you feel the heat. It's coming at you from every different direction. But there in the middle of all, he says, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. In fact, I've even written a book called Through the Fire, where I felt that this whole period of time, we went through the fire of trials and tribulations. And wow, starting in 2012, and we just wanted to help the homeless describe it all. If you'd like a copy of it, write me, Larry Rice, at P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, 63166. And it goes into detail of my personal struggles, and I've had to stay calm in the middle of it all. And sometimes I'm better at it than other times, and just through the fire that we'd been in the middle of all this. I'd be happy to send you a copy. Just request it and send it to P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, at 63166, and I'd be happy to send you a copy of that. But maybe you're going through some other fires at this particular moment. You're going through some real trials. You're going through some real tribulations. Saint Aquinas had this to say. He said, faith has to do with things that are not seen and hope with things that are not at hand. Faith has to do with the things that are not seen and hope with things that are not at hand. The secret to remaining calm in the midst of what may seem like a hopeless situation is what he said to us in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. I want to encourage you to read that chapter. It's example after example of people that could have panicked, they prayed, people that stayed calm and they trusted God. He starts out that chapter by saying in verse 1, he says, being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see, that's what he explains as faith. So I want to encourage you at this moment just to turn loose your faith, to adhere to trust in God totally. Back to Philippians again. Philippians chapter 4, verse 11 on. Paul has this to say about freedom. He says, I have learned the secret of being content, whatever the circumstances. I know what is to be in need. I know what is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all things, all this through him who strengthens me. Paul learned the secret of staying calm in the midst of whatever situation, circumstance he might be in. That's real freedom, to stay calm and trust God. And the secret to staying calm is just that, trusting in God, knowing that he's got everything all under control. And you and I can experience that peace that he gives us that passes all understanding. Henry Ward Beecham put it this way, every tomorrow has two handles. We can take of it with the handle of anxiety or with the handle of faith. Every tomorrow has two handles. You can take care of the handle of anxiety, or you can take care of the handle of faith. You know, are we going to be anxious and filled with fear, worry, and doubt? Are we going to trust God? Take care of the handle of faith instead of the handle of anxiety, and know that he will never leave us nor forsake us. I want to encourage you right now, just to, if you get a chance, to go outside and let's just move in the middle of creation for a moment. Can we do that? Just to move in the middle of creation and think about some of the different aspects of creation. If you're not able to perhaps go outside, and perhaps you might want to close your eyes and envision this, or you want to vigilant, but just to start experiencing God's peace at this particular moment. As we take a look and stay calm, let's think about the flowers. Each flower has a different texture. Each flower is made in so many different ways. And each one gives glory to God, each and every flower made in the wonderful beauty and power of the living God. What gives strength to these flowers on a daily basis? The sun that God has given, and the miracle of photosynthesis takes place. And then the gift of water. Just think about the water for a moment. Let the peace that passes all understanding flow over you at this particular moment. Let Jesus, who refers to himself as the living water, come and fill your heart and your mind. Just let it roll over you like it would right now, down a river or over a cliff and a waterfall. But let his water and his flowers, let his love and his power flow over you at this particular moment as you take the handle of faith and not anxiety. Taking that handle of faith and staying calm involves believing that the Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places and make your bones strong. As you reflect upon God's wonders of creation, let that promise of Isaiah 58:11 become yours right now. It goes on to further promise that as you stay calm and trust God, you should be like a water garden, like a spring of water whose waters never fail. Whose waters never fail. His love, his power, his presence is yours. As you take the handles of faith at this moment rather than the handles of anxiety. Martin Luther was convinced that the secret to staying calm was to live a life of faith in the reality of the love, power, and grace of God. He said, faith is a living, daring confidence in God's grace, so certain that a man can stake his life on it 1,000 times. Faith is a living, daring confidence in God's grace, so certain that a man can stake his life on it 1,000 times. Can we let it take place? The miracle of moving all this knowledge that we know that God can into our heart, knowing that God will, and experience His peace that passes all understanding. Instead of seeing every problem as a crisis, the person who's learned the secret of faith can remain calm and respond by faith that God is presenting these problems as opportunities. And that's what Rick Joyner said when he pointed out, the greatest faith of all and the most effective is to live day by day trusting Him. Is trusting Him so much that we can look at every problem as an opportunity to see His work in our life. I know that the secret to staying calm, instead of seeing this as a problem, but to see it as an opportunity to stay calm and to let Him do exceedingly abundantly beyond what we can even ask or think. In other words, if life hands you a lemon, make lemonade. Earlier, I made reference to the book that I invited you to get. It'd be great if you shared a gift of $10 or more to help cover these broadcasts, but regardless, write me. I want you to see this and experience this book of Through the Fires. It takes real circumstances and how I had to dig down deep and write in my journal and reflect on this and just miracles to keep us going. But when we were handed this problem by people moving into the neighborhood, working hand in hand with politicians that shut down a major shelter it was providing for hundreds of people every night, it would have been easy to throw up our hands and say, wow, if this is how this city's going to treat me, I'm out of here. But no, it handed us a lemon. Was this an opportunity that God wanted to do something different? Was this an opportunity that God wanted to thrust us out to the streets, and although we couldn't serve in that particular facility, we'd continue to try to make the improvements to get back in it. But in the meantime, our teams would go out on the streets. We'd move from the major shelter to the major transportation provider or to giving out hundreds and hundreds of bus tickets every week, and some weeks thousands. And reach out in a wide variety of other ways. Was this an opportunity for churches that had gotten somewhat complacent and just got used to dropping off their people at New Life Evangelistic Center at 14 Level Locust would suddenly have to deal with the homeless problem themselves along with their agencies, hospitals, and even the police department? Well, it was as the days and weeks and months and years passed following that. And was it an opportunity for us to exercise our faith, not to give up, but to give it to God? Look Through the Fire. It goes into detail on that. And again, you can receive a copy by writing us at New Life Evangelistic Center, requesting a copy of the book at P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, 63166. I have to confess, though, that during those years that book was written, I didn't always feel calm. It was a learning process. What God was doing was, I could see the problem. And sometimes it was easy to get bitter rather than better, but He'd have to deal with me. And so that I could just experience His peace and continue to move on, knowing He'd do exceedingly beyond what He can ask or think. Not only do a work out there in throughout the streets of downtown St. Louis, He also gave us a new headquarters at 2428 Woodson Road in Overland, Missouri, expanded our training programs all over the state as we continue to work to get back into 1411 Locust. A problem? We stay calm, trust God, and let it be turned into an opportunity. You've been given a problem now. You can become so wrapped up in that problem that even your prayer life, you wonder, why aren't I getting answers to my prayer? Because you're anxious. When the Bible says, be anxious for nothing but everything with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. There's no thanksgiving there. And the more you pray, the bigger the problem gets in your mind, when you should be thanking God for what He has done, is doing, and going to do. And then the problem will get smaller. And God, in your heart and mind, will appear bigger and bigger as you really see Him for who He is. You know, a lot of times, though, when we're given a problem, and I have a tendency to do this, is I try to fix the problem when I should be surrendering the problem to the Lord. Abraham, great man of God, a great example of faith, mentioned in Romans and other books, that great example of faith. But Abraham had been given a promise. He's going to have as many children as there are stars in the sky and sands on the shore. The trouble is, he's getting older. He was in his 90s. His wife Sarah's in her 80s. And she has to fix the problem. So she tells Abraham to go have a child with her handmaid, Hagar. Abraham gives in. He tries to fix the problem. And as a result, he created a problem that continues to this day where the Arabs and the Israelis continue to fight, and they're fighting because out of Hagar came Ishmael, and then later out of Sarah was born Isaac. And Sarah isn't so jealous, upset. She had Hagar sent away. God miraculously saved Hagar and Ishmael, started a great group of people. But Isaac then was the child of promise. As a result, we see the ongoing problem. We try to fix it, and we don't see it as an opportunity, and we make a bigger mess. God forgive us. Again, back to the basic. If we're going to claim that we're Christians, we've got to trust Christ. We got to let Him take over our life. You know, we can't play church. We got to be church. We've got to ask Him to move in our life right now, in our heart and our mind. So He's given you this opportunity. You got this trouble at this time, this problem at this time. Can you surrender to the Lord? Can you at this very moment just back up, surrender to God, let His peace that passes all understanding be yours in Christ Jesus? It might mean that you're going to have to get out of the four walls that seem to be pushing in upon you further and further. The more you cry out, the more you elevate the problem, the more the trouble gets. So get outside and go on a prayer walk. You say, oh, it's cold out there. Well, bear this in mind that, hey, spring's coming. Spring will be here soon enough. And so you may be going through a cold experience in your spiritual life at this time. Spring is coming. Hang on. Trust God. We go through these seasons in our spiritual life just like we go through in the physical life. So trust God and stay calm. Stay calm right now. I know you may be on the verge of panicking. It seems like your marriage is falling apart. No matter what you say, no matter how hard you try, no matter what you do, she or he just doesn't understand. No matter how hard you're working with that teenager, no matter how hard you're trying to straighten out, things only seem to go from bad to worse. Get along with God. Get in that war room, wherever it may be, that closet or whatever it could be, and just could lay it down before God and tell Satan, get your hands off my wife. Get your hands off my husband. Get your hands off my children. Get your hands off my parents. Get your hands off my boss. I'm turning them over to God right now. Satan, you're a liar. Be gone in the name of Jesus. I'm standing on the promises of the Word of God. He's promised that He'll never leave me nor forsake me. Over and over in the Word of God, we see these promises. And that's why faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. I have to read the Word of God daily. I have to read through the Bible once a year. And it's not enough for me just to read through the Bible. I've got to meditate on it, take notes in the margin, and just let the Holy Spirit speak and show me God's Word. I want to encourage you to do the same thing. If you don't eat for a while, you're going to get malnutrition. You're going to famish. When's the last time you just picked up the Word of God and tried to read through it on a systematic basis? Reading through the Word of God helps you to stay calm because you see how those who trusted God went through the struggles. I mentioned Daniel in the lion's den. I mentioned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace. I mentioned Paul in prison. I mentioned Joseph in the pit and in the prison. There's so many, one right after another, in the Word of God that God delivered him. And they do the same thing to you. They do the same thing to me. And that's why it says, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. We get into the Word of God, we read the Word of God, but then we have to apply the Word of God. And so as you do that, you'll see this problem that you're facing right now, where you have a hard time staying calm. As you continue to read, you continue to pray, and you continue to seek God, you continue to go out on those prayer walks, you continue to look at the flowers, or in the wintertime, the bare trees, knowing that all the time, what you can't see underground is that compost that's getting everything ready for the spring, and the budding of the new plants are going to come out soon. You'll see that. But the thing is that it's all going to build faith inside of you as you trust God at this moment to stay calm, to trust God. By daily reading the Word of God, we learn how to stay calm. And as we study the Scriptures, we learn how God did. He took Daniel from the lion's den, and He took Peter out of prison. He took Jonah out of the belly of a whale. Took Jonah out of the belly of a whale and Lazarus out of the grave. And as you and I trust God and we know that Jesus Christ, that He died on the cross, He rose from the dead, He came out of the grave, He's a resurrection and the life. He said, whoever believeth in me shall not perish but everlasting life. You and I shall also come out of the grave. Now, so many people, they say they're going to trust God when they die, but they can't trust Him right now. All these trials and tribulations and problems that are causing you to want to panic are just simply opportunities for you to trust God. And as you just kind of do that and experience this peace that passes all understanding, and you go through it day after day after day, when it comes that moment for you to just close your eyes and go into eternity, you'll know that He'll be there. He's simply taking you out of one realm of existence to another realm of existence. Because you've let all these opportunities that He's given you on a daily basis to cause you not to panic, but to pray. And that's what He desires to do in you and I at this particular moment. Because we've been told in God's Word, and here's what He tells us very clearly. He says, when you pass through the water, He tells you in Isaiah 43, 2 and 3, I will be with you, but when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze, for I am the Lord your God. He said, I am the Lord your God. So whether it's through the fires or through the waters, He said, they're going to destroy you. For I am with you. I am the Lord your God. Lord, I'm asking at this moment that we can receive this reality in the depths of our being, in the very essence of our DNA. We can hear you say, whatever you're going through, I am with you. I am your God. Father, we want to come before you right now. We want your living waters to sweep over us. We want them to work in us. We want to surrender, Lord God, this mess to you at this moment. We don't want to panic. We're praying, Lord. We're asking you right now to help us to stay calm, to trust you, and to see this problem that's gnawing away at our soul as an opportunity for you to do exceedingly abundantly beyond what you can ask or think. We come to you now in Jesus' name, and we receive this miracle. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask Him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.
You're feeling lonely, fearful, depressed, discouraged, then call the Dial-A-Message at this time, 314-241-7000. That's 314-241-7000. A special message just for you. So day or night, call the Dial-A-Message, 314-241-7000.